In part 4 of our lesson on radian measure, you're going to learn about using approximated values for angles in radian measure. The first thing to remember is that pi is a real number, not a variable. Pi is approximately 3.14. And a common error some students will make is to think of it as a variable when actually it is a constant. So it is a real number, just like the number 7 is a constant real number, or 1/2 is a constant, or negative 2.9 is a constant. Pi is a constant. Now, in this example, we're being asked to label the quadrantal angles with their approximate radian measures. So we'll do positive angles and negative angles. If we start with the positives, we know that here on the positive x-axis we start at 0. We know that the positive y-axis would be pi over 2. Now that is its exact value, so we can come over to our calculators and we can determine the approximate value. So if we take pi and divide it by 2, hit enter, we see that rounded to the hundredths place, pi over 2 is going to be approximately 1.57. Now over here on the negative x-axis, we know the exact radian measure is pi, so the approximate radian measure would be 3.14. Down here on the negative y-axis, we know the exact radian measure is 3 pi over 2. So we can come over to our calculators and take 3 pi divided by 2 equals, and we see that the approximate radian measure rounded to the hundredths place is 4.71. Now, coming full circle, we know that it would be 2 pi, and if we double 3.14, we get 6.28. Now, we can use these calculated values to go ahead and fill in the negative angle graph. We know we would have 0, and here at negative pi over 2, we're going to approximate that with negative 1.57. Negative pi is approximately negative 3.14. Negative 3 pi over 2 is approximately negative 4.71, and coming all the way around the circle in the negative direction is going to be approximately negative 6.28. In this next example, we have to determine the quadrant of each angle. So we're given that theta is equal to 3, and we know if we label our axes here, 0, 1.57, 3.14, and if our angle is 3, it's going to have to be in quadrant 2 between 1.57 and 3.14. So this would be theta equals 3. So then that's quadrant 2. So pause the video and go ahead and try these next two. Restart the video when you're ready to check your answer. So for theta equals 5.7, we label our axes 0, 1.57, 3.14, 4.71, 6.28, and we can see that 5.7 is going to lie in quadrant 4, because that's between 4.71 and 6.28. So that is quadrant 4. And for theta equals negative 6, we're going to need to label in the negative direction. So we have 0, negative 1.57, negative 3.14, negative 4.71, and negative 6.28. So our angle is going to be between negative 4.71 and negative 6.28. Here's our rotation, and that would be negative 6. So that's quadrant 1. In this next example, we have to determine whether each trig value is positive or negative. So the first one is cosine of 1.6. So here's 0, 1.57, 3.14. So then that means theta equals 1.6 would live here. And we know that in quadrant 2, cosine theta is negative. So cosine of 1.6 is going to be negative. Go ahead and try these next two on your own. Pause the video and restart when you're ready to check your answer. Here we're doing tangent of negative 2, so we have to label our angles in the negative direction. 0, negative 1.57, negative 3.14. So theta equals negative 2 is going to live here. Let's go ahead and put in the rotation. And we're in quadrant 3, where we know that tangent of theta has to be positive. So then that means tangent of negative 2 will be greater than 0, positive. This last one, cosecant of 3, so we're going to label our angles in the positive direction, 0, 1.57, 3.14. So theta is living here. Here's our rotation. Here's theta equals 3, and we're in quadrant 2, where we know cosecant of an angle has to be positive. So cosecant of 3 will be greater than 0 because it's positive.